I'm the founder of Wanjo Africa, which is a food processing and packaging company. I came here today for the Entrepreneurs Solutions Summit. And to be honest, I was impressed. I was asked to be a sponsor, one of the drink sponsors. And so initially I didn't want to until I saw the lineup of the speakers. Dr. Chris Kirubi, Auntie Myma, Belo Osagie were part of the speakers, and I so wanted to meet them. And so I decided, okay, I'll sponsor this thing. So I came here, and to be honest, I'm glad I did. I'm very impressed.
Can a lawyer really be entrepreneurial? I think we can. And I'm going to focus just on one aspect of being a lawyer. In some respects, advising businesses, advising entrepreneurs requires you to have an entrepreneurial mindset, because otherwise you don't understand what your clients are doing. So in co-founding and growing my law firm, for example, as an enterprise, it was obvious to me that I and my co-founder were indeed entrepreneurs, although many people wouldn't have thought of us as that. So why is that important? It's important, as I've alluded to already, because it means that there may be many more people out there who aren't thinking of themselves as entrepreneurs, who therefore aren't defining their businesses in an entrepreneurial way, who are not focused on the bottom line, who are not understanding what it is they need to do to make their businesses grow. It's also important because if there are that many entrepreneurs out there, then we need to question whether our government is taking them seriously. And I'll say governments because it could be any of the governments that we may have now or in the future. So all of these are things that we need to think about. Now, often we discuss entrepreneurial success on certain broad themes, and I've suggested six of them. I suggested to you that you don't get sufficient support, in my view, for all the things that you want to do. And this isn't to say that you can't be successful. We have very successful entrepreneurs in this room. But I'm one of those who believes that God helps those who help themselves. So I feel that all actual or prospective entrepreneurs have a responsibility both to themselves and to their country to make sure that they are building strong and sustainable enterprises. And in that context, some of these themes are extremely important. And I thought I'd discuss this by sharing some aspects of my entrepreneurial journey. As I said, I was the co-founder of a law firm. We started as a two-person law firm. Currently, we have 54 lawyers and 9 partners. And this has been, thank you, over the space of about 30 years. It's doable. It was painful. We learned a lot of lessons on the way. Luckily, we didn't completely fail, but we certainly had a few very hard times. So let me discuss what for us was the first item, identifying the opportunity. The question for us was there really a viable business opportunity in our prospective market? Now, remember, I was building a firm 30 years ago when the model for a law practice was very different from the practices that we probably see more generally nowadays. Much more traditional, generally sole practitioner, possibly two, you know, went to court in the morning, did a little bit of work in the afternoon, slept in between. We wanted to build a law practice that was much more of a business-oriented law practice. It was something that was developing internationally. And for us, the question was whether or not this would work in the Nigerian market. Would clients use a firm like ours? That was a question that we had to address. Would they be willing to buy legal services from a business rather than from a person. So we weren't doing anything particularly innovative, but we were trying a model that had worked elsewhere in our market. And that again is a suggestion that all of you can take up. Are there things that have been done elsewhere that you can do here and build upon? Every country has a culture that is different from the other. So there'll be different things that you need to take into consideration, but you can certainly take ideas and expand them. So we were setting up a business. We were therefore going to be a little bit less personal than might otherwise be the case. We were thinking of, you know, making money. We really needed to make sure that we had all our costs covered. Our billing practices were going to be different. We weren't going to be accepting chickens or goats or land. We actually needed cash. So this really was a little bit different than things that had happened in the previous times. We also wanted to set ourselves up as an institution. We wanted something that would last beyond us. The firm happens to be called Udoma and Belo Osagie, but most people actually don't call it that anymore. You find that increasingly it's becoming called UUBO. And part of the reason for that is that we now have a lot of partners who are gently edging the founding partners out. They're going to take it over, to be expected. And we're beginning to realize that it's good to have possibly a slightly more neutral name. So it's something that we are very conscious of, something that we accept, something that we are adapting our business to accept. But that was very much in our minds at the time that we set the business up. We didn't start with any data or market research. There really wasn't any information out there that we could rely on. So for us, we basically just had to go with our gut. And we took the view that in a country where there were an increasing number of businesses being set up, it was likely that people who were businesses themselves would appreciate the services of a business law firm like ours. And that was the basis on which we set up. Again, all of you, I'm sure, go through this. You have these products, you have these services, you're selling them into the market. 45 days passes by, 90 days passes by, there's a story, there's a long story. It's a struggle. How do you make sure you can get yourself paid? And I have to say that if you have somebody who has the ability to charm money out of people, that's a great entrepreneurial skill, and you should hold that person close to you. So, managing our money, we learned to do that. As I said, we decided very deliberately to operate on the basis of cash. But then we also had to generate revenue. And that, for me, was the dreaded thing of, as we call it in the legal services industry, business development, in other words, marketing. How do you sell yourself? The question was asked. How do you make people feel that you are worth the money that they are going to pay for you? Quality is obviously a major thing. And, you know, far too often, I think in Ghana, as much as in Nigeria, you're kind of told, oh, manage it, you know, it doesn't matter. Somebody's written something, it's grammatically incorrect, it's illogical, it's badly written. I don't see why one should manage that. Our view was, as lawyers, we were meant to communicate clearly advice that was not just legally sound, but also commercially useful. Remember, we were dealing with a business environment. We weren't going to be writing 30-page treatises on, you know, the value of X, Y, or Z as a legal proposition. We needed to give advice that our clients could just take and use. That was what we felt was our unique selling product, or at least what we sought to make our unique selling product. I think the last thing I always think about is, so what's the plan B? Do you know when you have to exit? If you're not generating any revenue, if you have no customers, if things are terrible, obviously, you probably will shut down and exit. But as I suggested, maybe there are other options. Maybe there are other things you can do with the business you have set up, with the organization you have created. But it's something that one must give very deliberate thought to.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure. Thank you.